Amen. Have you ever had just one of those moments where you heard something and you heard it differently than you had ever heard it before? That happened to me. I was sitting over there, and it was about 10 minutes ago when we read the psalm, right? You hide your face, they're terrified, and you take away their breath, they die, and they return to the dust. Right? You take away their breath, they die, and they return to the dust. What did I just say to the kids? The spirit is breath. Right? The word ruach, the title of the sermon this morning. Ruach. You need to say that with me. Ruach. Yeah. That's Hebrew. See, now you know Hebrew. Somebody asks if you know Hebrew, you can go, yes, I know Hebrew. I know the word for wind or spirit or breath, right? Ruach is that word. And when he takes the breath away from them, they die. When God takes the breath away from people, when the spirit is removed from us, we cease to exist. This is an interesting set of passages this morning, right? We have the Acts passage where we learn why we here at St. John's have worship at the time we do. Why do we worship at 9? Thank goodness, Kirkhoff. Why do we worship at 9 o'clock? Because Peter said to them, these men are not filled with new wine because it is 9 o'clock in the morning. It's a joke, Ruthie. It's okay. But the disciples are gathered together and these tongues of fire come down, right? The Spirit moves like a what? Mighty wind. And it fills them with the Spirit and they're given utterance to speak. And how do they speak? How do they speak? In other tongues? Do they actually speak in other tongues? We could talk about this all morning. If all of you spoke a different language and I stood up here and started speaking as the disciples did that morning, the disciples spoke so they understood what they were saying, but you all would hear it the way that you needed to hear it so that you would understand it. See, the same God that took away the ability for nations and tribes to communicate with each other back in Genesis, right? At the Tower of Babel. When the people were coming together to build a tower to climb up to be with God, God gave them, took away their ability to communicate with each other by making them babble, right? I can't understand what they're saying because they're speaking something different. The same God that took away the power of tribes to communicate gave in this day the power for the disciples to give a message of hope to all of the people that were gathered there in Jerusalem for the festival of Pentecost. And why were they gathered in Jerusalem that day? Greeks and Jews, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, Mesopotamia, those from Crete, those from all of those places. The Feast of the Harvest, the Feast of Weeks, the Feast of Shabbat. This is not a Christian celebration. They were there celebrating a Jewish holiday. How many of you knew that? We learned something this morning, besides your Hebrew word. Right? We learned that Pentecost is actually a Jewish holiday that happens 49 days after what other holiday? On Easter, Passover. 49 days after Passover is the celebration of the harvest, right? We have the festival of Passover, we have the festival of the harvest. And these holidays, these holy days, right? Holiday comes from the word holy days. These high holy days of the Jews were taken by the Christians and made into our high holy days. The days that Christ died for us, and the day that the Spirit came into our lives. And that day, according to John, is what day? We read this passage of scripture from John 7 weeks ago. What day is this? On that day, right? It says, it started when it was the evening on that day, the first day of the week, the doors of the house of the disciples where they were meeting were locked, and they were shut up in an upper room for fear of the Jews. And what day was that?
Easter.
Jesus comes into the locked room and he says, "Peace be with you." And the only other time in John where Jesus says, "Peace be with you," is where he's talking about God sending to the disciples the advocate, the paraclete. Right? He's going to give them soccer shoes. Oh, come on! He's going to give them a bird that speaks. Parakeet, paracletes. Thank you. The paraclete, the advocate, the one who comes and gives us all the answers and takes us out of trouble. Is that what the paraclete does? Is that what the Holy Spirit does? No. Paraclete literally means to come along with. The Holy Spirit comes along with us. And we are created anew, and we are given a breath of life that helps us to live what God has called us to be in the world. And then Jesus said to them again, after they figured out who he was, "Peace be with you." And what did he do? He breathed on them, is what the NRSV says here. He breathed on them.
Well, first of all, he's been dead now for 3 days.
Exactly. Would you want anyone who's been dead for 3 days to breathe on you? It's probably pretty nasty, actually. But the word here is wrong. It's translated just a little bit off. John says that Jesus breathed on them. And the verb here is the same verb that we find in Genesis chapter 2, when God created a man out of the dust, when he created Adam, and what did he do? He breathed into him. It's the same verb that's found in Ezekiel chapter 37, which is the valley of the dry bones. And God came to Ezekiel and said, "Can these bones live?" And Ezekiel said, "Only you know." But he made them come together. And when they were finally all together, what happened? God breathed into them. Jesus didn't breathe on the disciples. He breathed into the disciples. He breathed new life into them. Day in which God came to be with us. And he came to be with us to do what? To take us out of the world and to save us from strife and to save us from hurting and to save us from all of the things that are going to go wrong in a world out there that doesn't know God and doesn't see God. No. He gave us the Spirit to walk alongside with us. And he said, "And as the Father sent me, so now I send you." But if you follow that through, it doesn't really play out well for us, because you know what happened to the Son when the Father sent him. But that's where Jesus is sending us. It's filling us with the Holy Spirit and sending us out into the world so that we can share that same love with everyone out there. To go and to give what we've been given to everyone else. Because that same breath that came into us will continue to cycle through us. And we can give it out to anyone. Because that's what God did. In those last days, God will pour his Spirit out on them. And young men will... What do young men do? Young men will... Bless you. Young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. It'll be poured out even upon slaves, both men and women. Right? I will pour it out upon all flesh, on your sons, on your daughters. All of them shall prophesy. You see what Joel is doing there? It doesn't seem very clear to us. But what Joel is doing there is saying, everybody. Right? I'm not just going to give it to the men and to the old men who have sons and therefore have power. But I'm going to give it to the sons, and I'm going to give it to the daughters. And I'm going to give it to the slaves. And everybody's going to be able to see this Spirit and have it dwell in them. It's not just for a few. It's for everybody. And we're sent to go and give that same Spirit out. So allow God to breathe His life into you. Allow God to give you that Spirit to continually feed you in life and to send you out into the world so that you can share what God has given to you with everyone else. So go and share His love with everyone.